I'm sure this third day will also have you asking for more. For today we have Kavita Singh with delectable fare to feast your souls.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You all know that this is the third day of the Amrita Shergill National Art Week, which we started on the 18th of this month, commemorating her birth centenary year, and also paying tribute to her. We've dedicated this festival to Amrita Shergill. Kavita, she has done her PhD under Dr. Goswami. She studied here, and I've known her also almost for as many years as Shiva. And she has traveled so much from then. She's been all over the world. She's been curating shows. She's been writing on art. She's been writing on history of art. And she's been curating shows not only in India but also abroad. And she's running a wonderful, you know, program at JNU where she teaches now, which is like full of activities. Almost every week you get a new invitation by somebody or the other from rest of the world coming and sharing their thoughts and ideas at the JNU. Thank you so much for coming over, Kavita. It's almost homecoming. Thank you, and we are looking forward to listening to you.
Professor at the School of Art and Aesthetics, JNU, curator and writer, Kavita Singh is a name to reckon with in the domain of art history. Initial training at MS University, Baroda, and a PhD from Punjab University, Chandigarh, under Professor Goswami, as Devanji has just told you, set up for her a confluence of art, academics, aesthetics, and history, enabling her to explore the history of Indian painting, particularly the Mughal and Rajput schools, and the history and politics of museums, with special reference to India. Early in her career, she served as research editor for Marg Publications and also worked as a professional museum intern at the Asia Society in New York. As guest curator at the San Diego Museum of Art, she curated exhibitions of Indian miniature paintings in the US, Europe, and Asia. Apart from research and curatorial fellowships at the Victoria and Albert Museum, the Asia Society, and the Clark Institute, she has also received a major grant from the Getty Foundation for a collaborative project to study the place of museums in the social landscape of India today. In 2009, she led a curatorial team in setting up an exhibition titled Where in the World? Indian Art in the Era of Globalization, selecting works from the Lekha Anupam Poddar collection of contemporary Indian art. Ms. Singh's favored subjects are Sikh art, Indian folk and courtly painting, and the history of museums in India. Her name features regularly in many publications on art, as well as in catalogues for leading artists today, proving her prolixity in writing. The list of her published articles goes into a number of pages. She has also edited a number of books, the most recent among them being Influx, Contemporary Art in Asia, and No Touching, Spitting, or Praying, Modalities of the Museum in South Asia. Ms. Singh's popularity as an extremely knowledgeable speaker on art has grown with time. She has been invited to give learned presentations since 1994 at prominent institutions such as Max Müller Bhavan, Al-Kasi Foundation, the Habitat Center in Delhi, MS University, Baroda, New York University, Abu Dhabi, the National Museum of Kuwait, USA, Manchester University, and in Austria. We welcome you, ma'am.
So I remember the last time I was the recipient of a very lush introduction. When the introduction ended, I also started clapping like the rest of the audience because I was so impressed by what I had heard. I was waiting for this person to appear that it took me a moment to realize it's me. So please lower your expectations immediately so that you can actually relate to what I say because it's not going to be terribly profound. Now, as you've been told, I spend some amount of time, or I have been spending some amount of time recently, studying museums in India. And you might immediately wonder what on earth I could possibly be doing when I do that, because we all know that the state of most of the museums in our country is not very good. The thing is that if you're a cultural critic, then what you study doesn't have to be very good for you to enjoy studying. In fact, sometimes it's even more fun if things are not good and you get to analyze the many ways in which they are not good. So I find many different aspects of what is the situation with museums in the country, something very interesting to unpeel and look at. But it is not necessarily a question of critiquing something and saying, well, this is not functioning the way it should be. But I'm more interested in saying, okay, what do we have on the ground in India? And what are the museums that are there? What are they doing? And however poorly we may think that museums are functioning in the country, one of the important things about museums for us is that they become very important places in which some kinds of authorities or some kinds of important people put forward for you ideas of what is heritage. They put out some kind of a statement which we then either accept or argue with, but it becomes a proposition that you have to take into account. So what is heritage? And the short definition that I find most useful is this one. Heritage is the uses that the present has for the past. So if there was not something useful about a particular aspect of the past, we would ignore it, forget it, bury it. And it is that which is of some kind of use to us, which we recapitulate, foreground, polish, and present to others and to ourselves as our heritage. And then it has very profound effects on ourselves and our social formations. So I'm very interested in many different aspects of what is the formation of heritage or the ways in which it is foregrounded. And one of the areas that I have been somewhat interested in, which I would like to share with you when I look at what is happening in museums, is to look at the whole phenomenon of Maharaja tourism that we have in India today, and the way in which palaces are turning into museums and becoming part of this whole circuit of Maharaja tourism. Now, the circuit of Maharaja tourism is something that has quite a long presence in our country. If you look at the very early posters advertising tourism when it was an organized industry in its early days, you can see the way in which India is being sold as a land of Maharajas on golden howdahs. And if you look at a more recent poster, you can see that the image that is projected isn't changing all that much in all of these many, many years that intervene between these two posters. So there is something about the image of the Maharaja which is a persistent trope or symbol of our heritage, which is continuously being repackaged and resold to us. And I want us to take a look at that today. But today, something about the Maharaja and the Maharaja's style is in fact increasingly present instead of receding into the distance. And so you have more and more opportunities within the tourism sector to take Maharaja tours. You can go to a palace which has turned into a hotel and you can live like a Maharaja. You can enjoy the kind of views that Maharajas would have had. And if you are not the international palace hotel hopping tourist, you can certainly cook like a Maharaja or eat like a Maharaja or buy jewels like a Maharaja or wear clothes like a Maharani. You know, you can have all of these different ways of becoming close to what the Maharajas were, or in some way consuming some sort of a leftover image of what they had produced. In fact, so strong is this lure of the Maharaja that even where there aren't old palaces to be occupied, you have hotel chains making new palaces which look like old ones. All of the Oberoi's high-end villas properties are all new palaces that have been produced to look as though they were old palaces from some Maharaja's estate that you can enter and you can live in. Now, these kinds of sites, these expensive heritage hotels, are all places which are accessible to very high-end tourists. But also, you have a number of palaces that have turned into museums and which allow the general public in, and where the ticket money is not very expensive. And so these become places in which a very heterogeneous audience gets to interact and in some way come into contact with this mystique of the Maharaja. And it's something that is shared by a much larger public, and therefore it becomes a very interesting phenomenon for me to look at, to see what are these museums in the palaces and what kinds of stories are they putting out and what kinds of stories are being received by the people who go into them. Now, for one thing, I think that even the word palace museum is itself a very interesting term, because it's a kind of a oxymoron. These two things contradict each other. Because a palace is, of course, that sequestered space that a very elite person lives in, and a museum is a publicly accessible space that the democratic polity can go into. So the minute you have the term palace museum, you know that it is something from the past that has changed its relationship or its status in the present. So that itself should get us thinking about the ways in which it has changed and the ways in which people are able to access and approach certain things that were off limits for them. The question then becomes that if they can physically enter these places that would have belonged to a king or a queen in an earlier time, they're physically over there, how do they emotionally enter it? How do they intellectually enter them? How do they think about these places and the phenomena that they are coming into contact with? And are they able to make them their own in some way? So these are some of the interesting questions that, to my mind, are raised by the phenomenon of the palace museum. Now, when we start thinking about where these palace museums are located, I think it takes a little moment to reorient ourselves to look at a map like this, which shows the situation of India just at the eve of partition, where we tend to think that there was the British, then the Gandhi kicked out the British, and then we were independent India. But if you actually look at this map, the light orange areas are the areas that were the British dominions, and the dark orange areas were the princely states. So I think there were some 536 princely states which are occupying more than 40% of the territory which is today India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, which were princely states. So you can see what a complex polity there was, what a complex society there was, and what a big role that these Maharajas played politically, and how the process of actually marginalizing them, turning them into those kinds of people that they are now, who may have certain kinds of wealth but don't have political power, was actually a very complicated story, and is a story which actually raises a little bit of embarrassment in one as a modern Indian as one reads it, because there are all kinds of bad things that the state did, which I won't go into today, but if you're interested in looking at the details of this history, it's a checkered moment in our past. Anyway, so what happened at the end of this process when all of these many, many hundreds of princes were persuaded to join the Union of India is that eventually they found themselves robbed of political power. They found themselves robbed of a substantial part of their income. They were robbed of any kind of a public role by and large, but they were allowed to retain some palaces that they lived in, some amount of their personal property, and the state also promised them a privy purse, which was a kind of a pension in lieu of the kinds of earnings that they would have had from the revenue of the state. So they are living in these palaces, and the first Maharaja to say that he cannot afford to maintain his own home on his privy purse is the Maharaja of Jaipur. And so way back in 1958, he actually opens his own palace, Rambagh in Jaipur, as a hotel, saying that he can't maintain it if he is to occupy it by himself. 1 year later, he takes another older palace of his, which is the City Palace in Jaipur, and he opens a museum in it. And so what Jai Singh is doing in this case is that he is making a place for people to stay when they come to Jaipur, and he is giving them something to do or to see when they come to Jaipur. So he is producing the first infrastructure for tourism. As time develops, you have the golden triangle of Delhi with its international airport, Agra with the Taj Mahal, and Jaipur as a gateway to a traditional part of India where the past is still alive, as it were, presenting themselves as this very important circuit within Indian tourism. A little while later, there's another shock in store for the princes of India, where there is a 1971 war, there is an economic crisis, and Indira Gandhi says, who are these Maharajas to deserve a privy purse at all? They are parasites on our society. We will stop the privy purse altogether. And so what happens with this is that the income that the Maharajas had has completely vanished, and they are left lumbered with these huge rambling properties which are completely impossible for them to maintain. And so the example that is actually set by the Maharaja of Jaipur then becomes a good example where many other people feel that they might also benefit by opening their palaces to different kinds of commercial activities and allowing other people to use them so that they can get some money out of that. Now, when they decide to do that, there is something interesting in the case of Rajasthan in particular, because Rajasthan has been an impoverished kind of place. It's arid, it has very poor connectivity in terms of roads or railways. It somehow doesn't, you know, it doesn't manage to share in the greed revolution of Punjab. So it falls behind economically in many ways, it's underdeveloped. And yet at the moment when there is a need to develop tourism, or there is the sense that tourism is an option for us at this moment, at that very moment, the underdevelopment of Rajasthan actually becomes an advantage. And it becomes an advantage because it hasn't industrialized, it hasn't modernized in the way that other parts of the country has, and as a result, people have not had the money to tear down their old homes and make new ones. Yeah, they haven't sold off their old means of transport to buy cars. They have still using camel cart. They haven't actually gotten rid of their old ways of dressing, right? So underdevelopment actually turns into heritage, right? What you have in the decades that come is a whole chain of heritage hotels that are all over the state and which are crisscrossing different paths or heritage trails, where practically everybody who has a nice home, whether it's a palace or a haveli, ends up actually producing some form of heritage hotel. Now you can have heritage stays of many kinds in Rajasthan, whether it's a palace, whether it's a haveli, or whether it's a homestay in a village, or it's in a hut. No? So this whole range of heritage from different classes has now actually become part of the kinds of heritage experiences that are available to a tourist in Rajasthan today. And you also have, side by side with the making of these places to stay or these hotels, you also have the opening of a large range of places or portions of places as museums to be visited. So you can enter a place as a viewer to have a look at what was once in the royal domain in the past. So you see these beautiful structures. So in Jaipur, for instance, you have Amber Fort and you have the City Palace, both of which are available for visitors to see. For an international audience who comes to these places, I think there is a kind of a lure of the history, glamour, luxury, Maharaja trope that is there. But from watching Indian audiences in these places, I've often found that something slightly different seems to happen, where, for example, when I'm in Patiala, I feel that people take pride in the special Patialvi past, which gives them a sense of a local cultural identity, which today is getting flattened out in the overall composite identity of Punjab as a place, right? So I think that what a lot of people respond to in the ability to go to these kinds of places is a memory of a special identity rooted in a smaller locality than the kind of boundaries that we have in the modern state today. Now, there are many of these palace museums which have opened to the public, and I'm not going to be able to talk about many of them, but I'd like to take you through one to just give you a flavor of how many of these museums function and what they offer to the visitor. So let's go to Jodhpur, to the magnificent Mehrangarh Fort, which is situated on top of this mountain in such a majestic way. As you go into Mehrangarh, you start climbing up this winding path. You're under these amazing walls that tower over you, where there are these beautifully carved jharukas, and you pass through a succession of gateways, and you enter these exquisitely carved courtyards. And as you go through these places and you start entering the galleries, you start seeing room after room that is filled with these very lovely things. There are howdahs, or golden, silver, expensive howdahs that were mounted on elephants mostly. You have weapons, and you have some galleries with costumes. But most of the time, what you are actually experiencing is just a sense of the interior space. It's like walking through one period room after another, and you get a little bit of an abbreviated sense of what things were like in those days. It's more of an experience of architecture and of interiors rather than of art, which is what we expect in a museum. Now, in and of itself, this should not be something that is very odd for us, you know, that there should be this kind of experience, because it's a bit like the tour of the English country home where you're allowed in to see what a superior class enjoys and experiences. Here, we are in Udaipur, actually, in the thing of cars. But what I do find odd is that when we go to the Chandigarh Museum, we go to the National Museum, we go to the Chennai Museum, the things that we are going to see put forward over there are going to be paintings and sculptures. And who were originally the patrons of these paintings and sculptures was very often the royal families themselves, right? They would patronize the artists who were making the paintings, and they would also be patronizing the temple architecture. So how is it that these families, which were the patrons of what are considered the great arts in the national museums or the state-owned museums, are actually filling their museums with none of this stuff, but with the clothes that they wore, the howdahs that they were in, the cars that they rode, the china that they ate off. And my feeling about this is that all of this presentation that is there in the museums is not just about recreating how we lived in those days, but it's actually bringing you closer into contact with the king's body. That you're coming into contact with things that he has worn, things that he has put to his lips, things that he has held in his hands. And I think somewhere there is a residue of those magical beliefs that we had of the king actually being a semi-divine person, a person who could work miracles through his own physical being. You know? So there's some of that. And of course, on a more banal level today, there is also some of our obsession with lifestyles, where we want to see what kinds of dishes people had or what kind of table servings they had, and then go home and imitate them themselves. But whatever it is, I think that this is more of a sense of allowing the museum to be a place in which you transgress certain social boundaries that used to exist and which now you are able to step over that threshold, right? So that's what these museums are actually doing, I believe. Now, in a number of these museums, what you also have today are the people who own them presenting themselves as the custodians of a heritage which it is their duty to continue. One person who takes this very seriously, for example, is Maharana Arvind Singh of Mewar, who does a lot of conservation work for his palaces and the objects in his palaces, has opened a number of museums, is very concerned about how things will survive into the future. Here you have him also performing certain rituals that are traditional for him to do. For example, once a year, worshipping the horses to pay respect to them. So this is the Ashwa Pujan. But watch, this is actually a poster for the Ashwa Pujan, in which it is a ticketed event. And it's a ticketed event to which you, as a visitor to Udaipur, can come in and enjoy the spectacle and become part of the spectacle. So as you can see these photographs from the Ashwa Pujan that was performed a couple of years ago, you have actually the spectacle of the ceremony, and then you have the Maharana sitting there in state receiving the traditional nazar from a nobleman or a courtier over here and on this side, and also from a tourist on this side. Huh? So the lucky tourist who is able to afford the price for this is able to really feel that he became part of the Udaipur court for a day. In fact, in a number of these places, particularly in Jaipur and Jodhpur, the younger generation of the royal family has actually started event management companies in which they find ways to reprocess and repackage the heritage of their families. And so, for example, when you go to the City Palace in Jaipur, which is a museum by day, by the evening, it can become a venue in which you have a party or a wedding. And you have the event management company of Princess Diya Kumari, which advertises different kinds of menus that you can choose, where if you pay enough money, you will get exactly the same kind of reception that Queen Elizabeth II had got when she had visited in the 1950s. Right? And so, for example, here's a little extract where if for your wedding you are able to beat the price, you can even get the royal family to actually come and be part of your celebrations. Now, I've been reading the work of some anthropologists who have worked on indigenous groups in Africa, so tribal groups in Africa, as well as the indigenous groups in North America, people who live on reservations, who until now had been tourist attractions for tour groups who used to come to the area, and recently have started making their own corporations where they market themselves so that they'll get a share in the profit as well as manage how their image is consumed. And it seems to me that what these younger generation of these royal families in Rajasthan are doing is extremely similar, but the only difference is that the Aboriginal populations in Africa and in North America are very poor, and the Maharaja's descendants are very rich. Now, I'll take you as a counterpoint to one more site before I end, and that is in the south. I'm going to take you for a few minutes to Mysore. Mysore, as you all know, close to Bangalore, an area that has highly industrialized, has put itself on the global map as the center of India's IT industry. And therefore, for this region, its royal past is actually not that important in its self-definition or even in its local economy. But at the same time, there is a palace in Mysore. And that palace in Mysore has become one of the key or central issues or central, you know, it's a central linchpin of tourism in the region. Now, what happened in Mysore? In Mysore, the Maharaja of Mysore, again suffering from the lack of his privy purse, in 1976 told the government that I can't maintain this palace anymore, it's too big. So he approached the CPWD and he said, would you take it over for the purposes of maintaining and repairing it? He shifted into the west wing of this palace, and the CPWD took the central wing and the east wing. They restored it, they installed, they repaired it, and then they opened it as a museum where, again, you have galleries where you see the usual howdahs and costumes and paintings from olden times. And you can go through a succession of these very ornate period rooms in Mysore. Now, this Mysore Palace as a palace museum became very popular. And in fact, about 15 years after it had been opened to the public, the government got the idea that not only should this be a place to visit, but it should also be the center of an event. So let us revive the grand Dashera procession that used to be there in the days when the Maharaja was ruling. In the Dashera festival, what you would have is a wonderful celebration of this annual festival, which is very important for all royal families, because this is an annual reaffirmation of the king's right to rule, where what the king would go through would be a series of rituals which would reconsecrate him as a king. It's like, again, recrowning him. He would worship the weapons, and then as a kind of a newly reconfirmed king, he would do a procession and see the people and allow the people to see him. So this became a ritual which the government wanted to reinstate because it had so much pomp and splendor. But they said that, of course, as a ritual put on for tourists in democratic India, after feudalism has died, how can we have the Maharaja touring? So they had to modify the ritual. And the way in which they modified it is they seized upon the goddess who is the clan Devi of the Maharaja, and they renamed her the Mysore goddess. So from being the Raja's clan Devi, she turned into the city's goddess, and they started putting her in the golden howdah for the procession around the city instead of the Maharaja. And of course, who would flag off the procession then would not be anyone from the royal family, but it would be the district collector or the chief minister or somebody from the current powers that be. Now, what the Maharaja did was that when all of this tourism infrastructure developed and the visit to the Mysore Museum became very popular and the gate money that was being collected from the tickets became enough to pay for the maintenance, he told the government, thank you very much. My father asked you to do a particular job. You've done it very well. I'll take the palace back. And the government said, no way. So he said, but I, you know, it's mine. I never gave it to you. And so you have to give it back to me. So what the government did was that they rushed through an act in the state legislature forcibly acquiring the palace. So the Maharaja then went to court where the government lost the case. So then the government appealed and the appeal is in Supreme Court. In the meantime, the Maharaja got slapped with huge tax cases as a kind of a negotiation bid. So all of that is going on. So in the meantime, while the Maharaja is fighting to get his own palace back, in his wing of the palace, he has opened his own museum called the Residential Museum. And when you go into the Residential Museum, you see a version of the same things that you see in the main museum. You see costumes, you see carriages, you see clothes and saddles and so on. But as you can see, they look quite miserable. They are very poorly conserved and they are very poorly displayed. But in this case, the poor display, I think, is part of the message because it becomes part of the Maharaja saying, look, I've been despoiled by the government. The state has taken away my properties. This is all I can do. Please come and give me a donation. And so it becomes really like a statement of the iniquities of the state. So the two museums in this same palace are telling two different stories and are using heritage and history in two very different ways. The flashpoint that occurs every year is when the Dashera festival actually has to be celebrated. Because the Maharaja in private goes through all the rituals that he is supposed to go to in Dashera. He worships the weapons and he sits on the Rajgaddi and he is reconsecrated. But he goes on a procession afterwards, but unlike the old days when he would go on an elephant in his golden howdah around the city, he goes on a bullock cart inside the little grounds of his own section of the palace. So you have this very truncated little procession going on over here with these truncated rituals, which are almost like fossil rituals that are being performed in the palace, while outside for public consumption, there is this big procession which is happening with this invented goddess of the city being taken around on the golden howdah. The only problem being that the golden howdah is the Maharaja's property. And so every year the government is on tenterhooks about whether he will loan it to them or not. And predictably he makes a big fuss about it every time, but then in the end he does own it. To my mind, the kind of tensions that come up in our image of these two different processions, the one of this invented cult of the city goddess going around the city, flagged off by the district commissioner, and this other one of this Maharaja who actually owns everything but is sitting and sulking in his own little compound of the palace going on his little chakkar, to my mind, it actually brings very clearly some of the dichotomies, contradictions and ironies of the situation of the whole history turned into heritage of the Maharajas today, where as we try to just take what we want and use it as we like, there are still people around who can say, hey, what you call heritage is my history. And what do we do with that? I'll end here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kavita. No wonder at least three of the presenters during this Amrita Shergill National Art Week who will be in front of you, they were insisting they would want to pair with Kavita. Like, you know, I had to kind of let some of those go. They couldn't come because they wanted only Kavita. So Sheba prevailed. And she's so wonderful. Thank you, Kavita.